No, it's not your imagination. It is snowing in Las Vegas. Flurries coming down in the Summerlin area. We are your weather authority. Your forecast coming up with how much you can expect tonight.
Preying on pets, a hawk goes after a Yorkie. Incredible video of the Las Vegas resident trying to save her precious pup from the winged attacker.
And seeing double the science of cloning in our News 3 studios and on display at a veterinary conference right here in Las Vegas.
News 3 starts right now.
Desert flurries. Well, this is the scene tonight on the west side of town. Snow coming down in Summerlin and other parts of the valley as well.
And it looks like quite a bit, at least from this video. The question is, how long will it last? News 3, your weather authority, Jerry Brown, joining us now with the first look.
Yeah, it's a very wet, gloppy kind of snow. It's very treacherous driving on the west side of the valley. I say treacherous because we don't get to drive in snow a lot. I think going to the next hour, we're going to be under the gun. Let's close in. You can see all the action here in Clark County. Close it in a little further. Mostly rain now in the valley, but there is a very pronounced line here as we go to Valley Doppler. Let me move over because this is where the action is out here. And you can see the actual snow line has moved inside the 215 now. There's the Summerlin Parkway, and it's pretty treacherous driving west on there and on the 215 anywhere. West on the 215, you're going to have some problems for the next hour or so. Tomorrow we do it all over again. Winter weather advisory for the mountains. Also for any of our friends from California driving back, going to be very problematic. That's from 2 p.m. tomorrow through 4 a.m. Monday. And here in the valley, we could see snow in the 2,000 to 2,500 foot level, 2 to 4 inches worst case scenario. I don't think that's going to happen, but it should be an active weather day. Complete forecast up ahead. Heather and Gerard, back to you.
Oh, boy. All right, Jerry, we're going to be looking for that forecast. And we know a lot of you out there are pulling out your phones. It's what we do. We want to see your photos and your videos of all this snow. Just use your News 3 app to chime in. Well, tonight, we had a very special couple of guests here in the News 3 building. Cloned dogs.
Yeah, a national veterinary conference is here in town, and with it comes the latest science for animals.
News 3's Gabby Hart joining us live with how dog cloning actually works with that cute pup, too.
Well, everybody loves dogs, you guys, and it's no different, it turns out, for clone dogs. Now, the dog I'm sitting here with isn't actually cloned. She's just cute, and we thought, well, you might like looking at her. But we did have two clone dogs stop through our studio today, and we got some answers about the science behind it all.
Uh-oh. Help me.
After an accident years ago, Davis Hahn got a service dog named Booster, who became a crucial part of his life. When he learned Booster had cancer and might not live much longer, he was devastated.
I was facing massive depression with my dog facing death.
But Hahn heard about new cloning technology in Seoul, South Korea. So he flew out to learn more and eventually agreed to have Booster cloned.
What they did is they took the egg from the female and they took out all of her DNA. It's usually 50-50. The mother's DNA is in the egg. The father fertilizes the egg, so it's 50-50. They take the egg and they take out the mother's DNA. Now it's an empty egg. And they take 100% of the donor DNA, whether a male or female dog, and put it in the egg. And then they put the egg in the oven, and then the puppies are born.
And instead of one exact clone of Booster, the surrogate gave birth to two.
The father's name was Booster. He stole a toy from PetSmart. He was a thief. He was a booster. But I boosted his cells, sent him to Korea, and I get busted for it. Boosted and busted.
Now Hahn couldn't imagine his life without his service dogs, Boosted and Busted. He says the three-year-olds look identical to their father, but they picked up more than just his good looks.
And it's a little deeper than that, because some of the memory comes through in the cloning process. They started performing tasks that they were never trained to do.
They can open car doors and refrigerators to fetch anything their owner might need. And we're not making this up. We've got proof.
Bring me some water. Bring it. Yep, good puppy.
And if you were wondering if Hahn has plans to eventually clone Boosted and Busted,
find your leash, get it, bring it.
You're doggone right.
Cloning is very pure. It's simply a photocopy. And people say you're playing God. Uh-uh. I like what God gave me so much. It saved my life. I just want another.
And this is actually becoming a trend. Several celebrities have gotten their dogs cloned. Now, again, the dog sitting with me here right now is not a clone. This actually belongs to our producer, Sarah, who's in the back running the show right now. But, you know, if she did want to get Lucy cloned, It will cost anywhere from $50,000 to $100,000. Could probably buy several dogs with that amount of money. I'm reporting live, Gabby Hart, News 3.
Indeed you could, but Gabby, knowing a lot of dog lovers, including Sarah and myself, well, when you find the right one, I guess, if you have the money, it might be worth it. Thank you. A local family speaking out tonight, pleading with other pet owners to watch their small animals when outdoors. The family turned over surveillance video showing a large bird swooping in and grabbing their puppy. Now before we roll that video, we want to warn you, it may be hard to watch.
What started out as any typical Friday evening.
We were inside making tacos and we hear her crying.
Quickly escalated to something much more traumatic for Cecilia Celis and her puppy, Lulu.
And we just hear them like barking, crying. So we're like, oh, there's play fighting. A second later, I like look outside. We see a huge bird, like the wing fly up. So I run out and I yell at the bird. I'm like, get off my dog, get off.
With her family surveillance cameras rolling, Celis is seen rushing outside to this.
I thought she was gonna like die or something because that's a big bird compared to her.
That's her 2-pound Yorkie in the talons of a large bird, possibly a hawk.
It was just like had its wings over her, like hold her, his like meal pretty much.
From another angle, you can see when Celis runs out, grabbing a pillow, fighting to free her puppy.
I just wanted to like get it off.
The 15-year-old swings, hitting once, twice, three times before finally the bird lets Lulu go.
And its eyes like terrified. We like had like a eye contact like for most of the time.
This close up of the bird shows torn straps around its legs, leading Celis to believe it also is someone's pet.
And then we looked it up and there was other birds saying that they were missing and everything and that to contact them, but none of them really answered.
In addition to the calls, Celis says she and her family also rushed Lulu to a vet.
They punctured her neck.
Learning the best news, Lulu is going to be okay.
We were lucky he just had one nail inside.
But now they just want others in Southern Nevada to be on alert.
We just hope that the bird gets captured because everyone's saying that they've seen that bird around.
Not only looking out, but up when you let your pets outside.
A bird comes out of nowhere and it could happen to any of us.
From Las Vegas, Kendall Kim, News 3.
Well, we have seen some reports of a missing pet hawk. It matches the description of the one that was seen in the video. We did place a call to the possible owner. So far, we haven't heard back.
Tonight, an NHP trooper is recovering after diving out of the way of a drunk driver who hit his cruiser during a traffic stop. Now, police say it happened near the 95 and Ann Road. A Honda CRV driven by a 23-year-old hit the rear of the patrol car, according to NHP. And NHP says this is not the first close call for this trooper involved in the crash. He was at the Route 91 Harvest Festival as well. He is expected to make a full recovery. The driver now charged with driving under the influence and reckless driving. A community remembering the lives lost tonight after a gunman opens fire inside a manufacturing facility.
And coming up, what we're learning about the victims and the man police say should never have had a firearm.
A site we in Las Vegas knew all too well. 5 wooden crosses now placed outside a manufacturing warehouse in Illinois.
They represent the 5 lives lost when a gunman opened fire inside that building. NBC's Chris Pallone has more on why police say the gunman should have never had a firearm.
Many questions remain after the country's latest workplace massacre. This one happened in Aurora, Illinois.
Attention all police, Aurora does have an active shooter.
5 people shot to death Friday at a manufacturing plant that makes plumbing valves. Police said Saturday the shooter, Gary Martin, never should have had a gun to begin with.
Absolutely, he was not supposed to be in possession of a firearm.
Investigators say Martin started shooting in a meeting in which he was being fired after 15 years on the job. 5 years ago, state police ordered him to turn in his gun when they discovered Martin was a convicted felon, the same .40 caliber Smith & Wesson he used Friday.
After a FOID card revocation, the subject is provided a letter stating that they need to relinquish their firearms, and we're looking into why that did not happen.
Outside the Henry Pratt Company plant, friends and co-workers are remembering the dead. Police identified them as human resources manager Clayton Parks, intern Trevor Wayner, mold operator Russell Beyer, plant manager Josh Pinkert and stockroom attendant Vicente Juarez.
The words can't even describe how good of a dad he was. Oh, he was a great dad.
Five police officers shot during a gunfight with Martin are all expected to survive.
I also want to point out that, you know, we're thinking about the victims of these families, the families of the victims. That is also foremost in our thoughts. And as you know, we're trying to take care of each other.
Police shot and killed Martin after his rampage, meaning some answers about what caused him to do this might never be known. Chris Pallone, NBC News.
Police said Gary Martin had been arrested at least half a dozen times since his felony conviction in the 90s. His latest arrest in 2017 for disorderly conduct and criminal damage to property.
Chaos during a performance of Hamilton.
Coming up, what caused audience members to stampede toward the exits during the show.
And trying to get out of a slump, the Golden Knights shake things up ahead of their home game against Nashville. Did it work? Amber has more ahead in sports.
Chicago police took two brothers from Nigeria into custody for attacking an actor, only to release them hours later, no charges. They're now saying they believe Empire actor Jesse Smollett paid two men to orchestrate the assault on him. Investigators searched the two men's home, finding a black ski mask, bottles of bleach, and an Empire script. Police sources say one of the men worked as an extra on the TV show. Smollett's attorney releasing a statement saying there is no truth that the actor played a role in his own attack. The story, of course, though, getting a lot of attention online. We'd love to know what you think. Join the conversation on our News 3 Facebook page.
Chaos erupts during a performance of Hamilton in San Francisco. Police say during the performance, a woman had a medical emergency inside the Orpheum Theater. It happened at the same time that gunfire was heard during a duel scene of the play on stage. Audience members tied the events together. They got confused, an error leading to a self-evacuation. Police say three people were injured in the chaos. They did have to end the show early.
News 3 is your weather authority. Boy, a lot of pressure's on for Jerry Brown here with the snow.
We got a little chaos going on up in Summerlin weather-wise.
It feels like it.
Well, the snow is pretty much diminished now. We're just talking about rain, so that's the good news. Still kind of slippery roads out there, so drivers, best not to drive, especially on a Saturday night when people have been imbibing. Let's go to it. Start off Saturday morning with the skies nice and blue. It was cold, but it looked nice. Then the clouds bubbled up over the mountains. We got those afternoon showers that shot through. Then we cleared out, and then, here we'll go through it once more. And it looked pretty good, but then guess what happened? We got some more rain, and, of course, the snow tonight with the falling temperatures. So it's another view of it through this afternoon. It's going kind of slow there. Okay, CSN tonight, 7/100ths of an inch. That's rainfall, 41 degrees. Winds have come down. Over the last hour, humidity at 82%. Over in the lakes, 9/100ths in terms of precipitation, 5 from the north northwest and 40 degrees. And how about Faith Lutheran out in Summerlin, Hualapai and Charleston, 12/100ths of an inch. Palo Verde High also at 12/100ths. Last I checked, 37 degrees there with a light north northeast wind. You can see temperatures have risen. If you watched the news at 10, we had 30s all across the Western Valley. Now they're starting to come up into the 40, 41 degree range. And around Southern Nevada, 41 in Pahrump, 30s up the 93 there, 41 at Boulder City. Top of the hour, 42 out at McCarran Airport, the real cold stuff as you move up north in our state. 54 was the high today, our 12th day below normal and 4/100ths. Last time I checked out at the airport, that figure could go up by midnight. All right, here we go. A lot of moisture in California, but some energy broke off tonight, and you can see we were under it. But it's starting to diminish now. Still moisture in the valley, as you can see, Valley Doppler, but that pronounced snow rain line has now disappeared, and what we're talking about is just moisture in the Central Valley moving out and should be gone, I would hope, after midnight as it's moving to the east pretty quickly. Overnight lows, plenty of cold air aloft, and it'll be chilly at the surface as well, as you can see. Highs tomorrow, 54 today. We're talking 40s tomorrow. I mean, 45 to 50 probably tops. 37 overnight tonight, a cold one with the showers ending, 49 tomorrow, and then they redevelop tomorrow afternoon, 8 a.m. 40. We should see a little sun, but by noon, we could be in the soup through the afternoon hours with a mix of rain and snow showers, as I told you earlier. Snow showers likely up on the mountains, 4 to 7 inches possible over the Spring Mountains. And here we go, 7-day forecast. President's Day or Washington's birthday, take your choice, should be dry and chilly. Some sunshine on Tuesday, but then by Wednesday night, another system slams into Vegas. What have we done to deserve that? And the next one is going to be stronger than this one.
Oh, man.
It's all in how you look at it. Yeah. It could be positive.
We had a nice January.
We sure did.
I don't know.
All those 60s, was nice.
Bring it back.
It'll come.
Thanks, Jerry. All right, let's check in with Amber now. She's here with a look at the day's sports.
It's now time for the News 3 Station Casinos Sports Desk.
Hi there. I hope this weekend is treating you well. Vegas backup goaltender Malcolm Subban hoped to play well, getting his first start since January 6th tonight when the Golden Knights hosted Subban's brother, PK, and the Nashville Predators. Mama Subban was in the stands. I read her husband's book, and according to him, she is known to say, "Holy moly, what a goalie," and might have said it tonight when her middle son made this stop about 4 minutes in. Still first period here, no score. Cody Eakin popping the puck on ahead past all the defenders, and Max Pacioretty, he's at the net and persistent, jamming it on in, and for the first time in 7 games, the Golden Knights get on the board first. Yeah, a second period now, Vegas still up 1-0, and they're on the power play. William Karlsson here to Riley Smith, to Brandon Peary. Peary's first shot blocked, his second. That one goes in, and the Golden Knights, with another goal off Pacioretty's stick, would snap a 5-game home losing skid. Final score 5-1. They play the Avalanche in Colorado Monday. From hockey to hoops, the Runner Rebels were on the road to face the San Jose State Spartans, a team they beat by 38 points at home. Today in San Jose, UNLV was favored by 13. Here up 2-0, Rebel freshman Joellen Tomboy sinks the 3 to extend that NCAA record for UNLV of most games in a row with a tray. But after that, San Jose State went on a 6-0 run, and they would keep this game competitive and close. With the first half clock winding down here, the Spartans trying to extend their lead, and they do so with a pretty alley-oop. Those Spartans led 31-28 at the half. Second half now, with about 8.5 minutes left, UNLV leads 50-48. Noah Robotham to Ntamwoy, he pulls up and hits another triple, 5-for-9 from long distance today, and hotter than a cheap pistol, as broadcaster Joe Cravens noted. The Rebels and third-year head coach Marvin Menzies win 71-64. Now 8-5 in the Mountain West Conference. The Rebels play 2-9 Wyoming in Laramie on Tuesday. And the Las Vegas Lights Football Club wrapped up their preseason today with a 2-2 draw against the Colorado Rapids. So two good games against Major League Soccer clubs. Might be a turnaround season.
Whatever happened today, let's just keep that going.
A bunch of winning.
Yeah, we like
it. Keep the mojo, not the snow, but keep the mojo. Okay, stay with us. We'll be right back.
Tonight, it is your average yoga class, sort of, but with a beer in hand.
Beer yoga, returning to Las Vegas at Hofbräuhaus, right off Paradise and Harmon. Today's hour-long class featured, it was free, guests bringing their choice of beer. And then following the class, people were treated with gluten-free or vegan dining options at the German Hall.
Some of those poses looking a little wobbly, maybe a little too much Hofbräu, not enough,
Zen.
Yeah.